On your marks, get ready, shop. Nothing haunts us women like the things we didn't buy. Today's show is brought to you by Target, otherwise known as Tarjay. What woman doesn't shop at Target? Come on, let's keep it 100. Online shopping is the best. You know why? You can shop with no makeup, no bra, and a girl, a glass with sangria. Now that spring is finally here, we're officially in spring cleaning mode. You'll get from 20 to 30% off vacuums, wallpaper, slipcover pillows, and an assortment of rugs. You can access all the shopping links from my website at ninababel.com/podcast, and you're going to look for episode number 11, which gives you this week's store discounts. If there's anyone out there listening for the first, second, or third time, girlfriend, I need your 5-star rating and review after you listen to any of my episodes, including this one, by clicking the ratings and reviews section in the iTunes or Stitcher app. Then this is what you're going to do. You're going to select 5 stars, you're going to title your review, and then write a description. I mean, that's easy breezy 1, 2, 3, right? Episode, I featured a spotlight interview with two high-profile influencers on eating disorders. In case you missed it, Subi Zimmerman is also known as the Instagram expert who publicly reveals for the first time her personal struggle and recovery from bulimia. Additionally, I interviewed Claire Misko, who's the CEO of the National Eating Disorders Association, who shares their mission and vision for individuals and families who have been affected by an eating disorder. After this segment, yo, I strongly felt that as human beings, this is a must-learn topic, especially if you're a parent. I really didn't understand the magnitude of this illness, or in fact, I just misunderstood it. But it's a life and death situation for both men and women who suffer from any eating disorder. So check it out. It's episode number 11. Girly Nation, are you ready to keep it 100?
Yes, I'm ready to keep it 100.
I'm ready to keep it 100, girl.
You know I'm going to keep it 100.
My hand is raised. How about yours? Let's get this pot day started.
Let's get it started. Let's get it started. Yeah, yeah.
Okay, everybody. In today's episode, I'm talking about sex. Did you get it? I mean, did you get the traditional sex talk, birds and the bees conversation, or even just sexuality? Yo, you're gonna learn there's many women out there that didn't get the sex talk, and you're gonna learn how they educated themselves. We will learn the difference between the sex talk and sexuality. You will hear one mother who did get the sex talk broke the cycle of communication. If you struggle with the talk, I'm going to share my secret sauce, and I have a special guest who will let you know what young daughters want and should know. Today, I have a shit ton of stuff to tell you, Girly Nation. And in all seriousness, do you realize how many of us did not get the sex talk? It's friggin' shocking. On today's episode, I'm going to get everybody up to speed on this alarming fact. Before we get started, this is my call to action to everybody listening to this episode right now. For kicks, I want you to ask 10 people in your circle if they had the sex talk from their mother or both their parents. Come on, everybody has 10 friends, colleagues, clients. Just pick up the phone, text, grab a pen, and you know what? You're going to email your response to feedback@ninababel.com. I want you to do this by April 12th. So mark your calendars now. April 12th is the deadline. And I'm going to report out the results soon after that. Mothers avoid being straightforward with the talk. And in this episode, we've decided to own up to all of our past ignorances and half-stepping. Dr. Kevin Hilton is the professor of sociology with a specialty in human sexuality at the University of Maryland College Park. Dr. Hilton explains that there's a generational miss with having this whole sexuality discussion.
If you were to have a discussion with your parent, you dare not ask them, tell me the clitoris, and what exactly are its function and how that works, right? Or if you were to ask about vaginal fluids, or if you were to ask the average person to point to what each of these parts represents, labia versus vulva versus clitoris versus urethra versus whatever, they don't know. If you were to even ask the average person, especially women, what is an orgasm, they might not know. They'll assume that just having fluid coming from their vaginas is an orgasm, and they don't equate that with the physiological feel. And part of it is, well, a man has fluid coming from his penis, so therefore, if I'm having discharge, then that simply means that I'm having an orgasm. And lots of women run around with that. Lots. And so the issue is that our parent who has failed to do that in a way that says, let's have a discussion about how this works. And so why they're reluctant to have that discussion, they too never received the talk, and they too were not as informed. And so the best that I could do is I can tell you what I've read in this book in terms of how this thing truly works, but that doesn't happen. For parents who are, if you would, formally trained, might take the extra step to say, I really need to understand this better, and I need to find a way to sit with my child to kind of explain this in a healthy, normal, non-embarrassing kind of way, that will resonate well with them. But that just doesn't happen as frequently. And a lot of it is really tied to social class. Not social class in the literal money sense, but how much education a person have to understand that sex is a normal part of life. And if I'm going to have that discussion with my child, I have to normalize that in a way where it doesn't feel like it's spooky taboo. Or taboo or anything like that. Right. And most of us, unfortunately, most parents, unfortunately, because of how we were raised, you pass it on just generation after generation.
Do people automatically assume, okay, now I'm on birth control, I could have sex? I mean, even though I'm using it for my cycle.
That's the natural, you may not be feeling that way, but your parents might naturally feel like, if I'm giving you permission to do this since it's birth control, then am I giving you a sort of
carte blanche to
say it's okay if you choose to do it because now you can't get pregnant. Versus just saying, I am trying to prepare you in the event this happens. Or even making the discussion a little bit more open where you can say, now that we've had the talk, if you find yourself in a place where you're contemplating this, let's talk about it and work through how you feel and what's good, what's bad, because there are some things that you're going to need to navigate. And those kinds of discussions just simply never happen.
So like all my episodes, this one has no color lines, right? My rainbow coalition of women are here with their real life personal stories from Black, Indian, White, Asian, and Latina. I asked them if they had the sex talk or any conversations about sexuality, period. Here's what they had to say.
It definitely was not my parents.
I didn't have like an open relationship with my mom.
It wasn't a household issue. We didn't talk about that.
I've never had that.
Oh my gosh, I had no resource at the time. It was awful.
There was like no truth. You know, like, we didn't really talk about things.
So I don't remember like them having conversations with my mother.
But I didn't get the biology part of it until like in high school.
I didn't have like really any communication with my mom about relationships.
The birds and bees. The birds and bees.
There was no birds and bees.
So my sample of women ranged in age from their 20s to their 40s, and I probably in total talked to at least 15 women. But here are the results. Are you ready? 1 out of 15 had the sex talk with a parent. What is up with that? For real. So it is alarming, and I have to mention one thing before I get in deeper, and that's both Planned Parenthood and Time Magazine featured a study last October. No, actually, it was October 2014. I personally think their numbers are conservative and too scary positive, but for argument's sake, it's still worth sharing. At least we can get a baseline understanding and compare it to today's episode. So Planned Parenthood and NYU Center for Latino Adolescent and Family Health surveyed a national representative sample of 1,663 pairs of parents, roughly talking a sample size over 3,300 parents. And this also includes their children, which ranged in age from 9 to 21. And the whole purpose of this study was to get a sense of how American families of all backgrounds are communicating about sex and healthy relationships. So what the inquiry found, that 8 out of 10 young people have had the talk with their parents about sexuality. Okay, so you're telling me 1 to 2 generations later, we've made this giant leap for sexual mankind? Bull junk. I'm not buying it.
And for a society that doesn't educate their children on sex, they sure are pretty open to all kinds of sex.
OMG, please drink this up.
So now women are going to reveal if they had the sex talk. And if they didn't, they're going to tell you how they were educated or not. So let's hear what these college women had to say about their sexual conversations with their mother.
But I remember when I was 7, my best friend told me what sex was, and then I had to have the talk with my mom.
Learned from my friends and my sister too, because she's older than me, so she kind of got me down the right track that my mom, because my mom didn't tell her about it, so she had to find out through her friends. So I found out more through my sister.
Orgasms. We'll talk to friends about not really something I've reached that comfort level with my mom yet. We're working on it.
My mother really, never spoke to us about anything about pregnancy.
Good old sex ed. Some women learned about sex through sex ed class in high school. I don't think my mother even knew my school had sex ed. Remember, sex ed in school primarily teaches abstinence, especially in Catholic school. And oftentimes, sex ed is a substitute for health or gym class. And then you know what? In some other schools, it's entirely non-existent.
Right. So the sex talk should really be two parts. The first part is, what is sex in general? Why is it pleasurable? And why do people want to have sex? Or why do they have sex? To better understand what's likely to happen during sex, which might lead to anything from becoming pregnant to acquiring an STI or STD to any of the other piece. What most people will focus on is the second part of that is, don't have sex. Or if you're going to have sex, use a condom. And here's why you need to do it. But many parents fail to talk about all of the reasons why a child or a young adult might be curious about sex. What's happening with their hormones? Why they turned on? What does it mean to be turned on? What are the ways in which one might be able to deal with that? So that way, sex is not the only outlet. Perhaps masturbation might be one way to deal with that. So, if I know that there's a way to pleasure myself or to reduce my sexual arousal by simply engaging in masturbation, then I might not be so inclined to have sex. And if there's a way to normalize it, to say it's healthy to do it that way, in the appropriate context or setting and so forth. And that holds true for boys and girls. It's a little bit easier for boys, I think, simply because boys naturally at a certain age will have what's referred to as nocturnal emission, and they'll discover that they can have an orgasm and can find ways to stimulate themselves to get that. Women don't have, young girls don't have nocturnal emission, so they don't know what an orgasm is, and when they do discover it, it might be accidental in many instances for most of them. But it's never where anyone teaches them that here's a way in which that you can have an orgasm, so that way you can wait until you find the right person to have sex with and you can have an intelligent discussion about it. So yes, there's two parts to it.
What ends up happening is this. Most of us end up figuring it out all on our own. Maybe because of the fact that we've learned so many wrong facts, myths, and it just has us so paranoid that we never want to have sex, at least not right away. Or the fear of doing something completely wrong that can cost us our life. Let me tell you something. Google University has filled more gaps than they realized of sex ed students and graduates who've learned from porn, online educational books, TV shows, sex ed-based websites, YouTubes, and even chat rooms. For most of us, the talk ranged from don't do it, to a scared tactic, to a myth, to not saying anything at all, or some losing their virginity before the talk ever happened.
I think in our culture, sex is viewed as a taboo, so to speak. I shouldn't use the word taboo, but it's not the thing that we do. No one is having sex, even though everyone is having sex. And so if I were to have the discussion with you about sex, I might not know it well enough and I'm not that comfortable because no one had that talk with me. But I think more critical, if I'm having that talk with you, then I might be even disclosing some things about myself. Does that make sense? So it's kind of like if I'm having a discussion about how sex is, and sex is supposed to be private, well, mommy, do you do that? Right? And that makes a person, an adult, uncomfortable to admit to the fact that sex is normal. And yes, Dad and I have sex all the time, and it's great. It just sounds weird or quirky to say that. We skirt around that without having to disclose or increase the likelihood that your child is going to ask you questions about yourself. Well, let's just keep it at the high level. Don't ask me any questions. Just don't do this. And if you got to do it this way. And just we'll leave it at that. And some of it is culturally, because, you know, in North American culture, and I'm including like the Caribbean and anything but south of the United States, you know, people don't have those discussions. But when you get to parts of Europe, they're a lot more open about it. And they're open about nudity and sex and things like that. But we're just not socialized to have those kinds of discussions. And so in the end, and then if you couple that with issues around religion and faith, it's just a really tough discussion to have. Because to have the discussion would be to suggest that I'm encouraging you to have sex. All right. So even if I were to have a discussion with you about birth control pills, even if it might mean that it's going to reduce any discomfort that you might have during your cycle, and say, okay, I know that if you're on the pills, it might not be as painful, but if I encourage you to do that, does that mean I'm giving you permission to have sex?
So last year I was babysitting my girlfriend's children, and her son was about 7 at the time. And he asked me, Auntie Nina, where do babies come from? First, I felt flattered that he was even comfortable enough to ask me. And then I paused and went into panic mode as he looked me innocently in the eye, patiently waiting. It was a lost teachable moment that I decided to forego. But during that split second, I was like, do I tell him or not? And if I do, what should I share with him? Do I overstep my bounds? Or do I defer to his parents who have that responsibility to explain it? So after the fact, it turns out he's never asked either of his parents, who are my good friends, the where do babies come from question. The only reason there was a 2-minute feeling of awkwardness is that feeling of a child coming to you and you didn't proactively approach them with the sex education, which just leaves you off guard.
Well, I think you have to ask, what is the end goal of the talk? You know, what is the person trying to accomplish? Is it a discussion to deter a child from having sex or becoming pregnant? Or is it to understand the whole bigger realm of...
For me, it was the first one.
Okay. And that's the norm for most parents. Versus, let's look at the bigger picture, not just in terms of becoming pregnant, but also having sex and everything else in between. And so it's never, let's look at the big picture. It's always, let's look at this thing. I don't want you to become pregnant. Or worst case scenario, since you shouldn't be having sex, getting an STD or an STI. And so I think that there are three factors that I would say that probably contributes to whether or not a person will have that talk. One is going to be culture. So a lot of it has to do with the culture from which you are. Some cultures are much more conservative than others. The other is going to be religion. So if a person is really religious, it's an uncomfortable discussion because, you know, in theory, you shouldn't be having sex anyway unless you're married and so forth. And then third, what I'd loosely call social class. And the emphasis here is really more so on a person's educational level, right? So if you have a parent who is a little bit more formally trained, they may understand the significance of having these discussions. But if you're having a person who's not that formally trained, they may not get the significance of it, and they might not know exactly how to do it either. Because it is an uncomfortable discussion to have. And so if I don't really know it and no one ever gave it to me really and I never took the time to find out for myself, I'm just going to give you the quick and dirty. Just don't have sex. And if you got to do it, make sure you do this. And if you get pregnant, I'm going to kill you. Right? Instead of saying, you know, let me take the time to better understand this. And so I think, you know, you can't really say to a person who's of a particular faith, disregard your faith. But you can say in the context of faith, here's what you can do. You know, so if you're Catholic or whatever religion, here's how you can frame the discussion. You know, recognizing that you might not be suggesting or encouraging your child that they should have sex before marriage. if you're of a particular cultural group where it's conservative and people just don't have those kinds of things, that's a little bit more difficult to overcome because a person's belief system and values are steeped in their cultural practices and norms and things like that. And then lastly, as I said, with the just being formally trained and knowing how to read or find videos or resources to deal with that, you know, that's a hard fix. So the long and short is that there isn't an easy way to say to someone, here's, you have the discussion. You have to kind of figure out, where's this person in the realm of those three things, and what might be a good way to get them to recognize why this is an important discussion.
So my story. Some of you who have been following me are familiar with my story from previous episodes, so I'm going to give you the itsy-bitsy version. My mom used clearly a one-and-done approach, and she dropped these mystery one-liners that were way above my head when I was younger, but I ended up decoding them as an adult. In hindsight, I had it scary good. I mean, the good part of it was it was better than what most women got because I had something at least to work from. The scary part, what I had to work from, wasn't that great after all.
All right, so there's a stronger likelihood of some more short-term implications, right? In that, for example, if it's a young child, 14, 15, much more likely to become pregnant at an earlier age, and so some of this plays a part in teen pregnancy, or much more likely to get an STI or STD at a much younger age because they didn't get the full talk in terms of here's what you can do to prevent this from occurring or from that from occurring. Long term, you're still guessing because no one has ever told you, so the best that you can hope for is what does your peers tell you? What are your peers telling you? And then it's more, I think, much more likely to end in a lot of trial and error as you go along. You know, in any of the other areas that we spoke about, be it the sex talk or the taking care of yourself talk or the period talks. Yeah, that's likely to continue, which is what contributes to that cycle where my mother doesn't have the sex talk with me because no one had that sex talk with her, and so I don't even know a whole lot more, you know what I mean? So the cycle never seemingly ends, and usually I think that, you know, for a parent who doesn't do it well, it's probably a sign also of, you know, some of the things that might have occurred in their life from the time that they either had the little sex talk or no sex talk. Enough to not even be comfortable saying, I think it's important that I get this right so that way I can pass it on to my daughter so she doesn't make some of the same mistakes that I've made. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm.
And that's how you, you know, that's kind of how the part of the challenge with like breaking that cycle. And it's a pretty good indicator. If a parent is having a tough time doing the sex talk, chances are there's a lot of other things that occurred in their life that why they're still holding on to some of those views.
I mean, I deserve to know how my body works. And I had a baseline introduction, so when it came to health class, I was able to connect some of the dots, but that age, you're fully not paying attention, peeps. Like, let's be real. We're giggly young girls in a room full of other girls and boys, and we're not taking it seriously. But now I'm gonna turn the mic over to Girly Nation. No doubt their stories trump mine this time. These women didn't get the sex talk and reveal the type of relationships they had with their mother. Jen is in her 30s and her mom didn't even think it was the school's responsibility to teach her about sex.
And my mom, even when it came time to have the talk in school, she was like, I was like the only girl whose mom wouldn't sign a form to have with the school, let her participate in the talk. And I was like, oh my gosh, how embarrassing. Everyone's going to know I'm like sitting out, I'm not allowed to be with them, how embarrassing.
Right.
So my best friend's mom was like, I want her to learn, you know, told my mom, I remember, I want my daughter to learn about this stuff. And my mom was like, well, I don't want to be the one to tell her about it. I always remember that. So I went to that talk. I ended up going. My mom signed the form. And then after that, I don't know if they put your name in a database or what, or if you're just in some database, but once you're born, from like Social Security, who knows?
Right.
And then you get this little care pack. I didn't learn anything from my mother. I like she said in the beginning when I was like 13 and there came time for a talk, you know, at school, it was like she didn't want me to participate, but she also didn't want to tell me any, she didn't want to be the one to teach me about it, you know. But hence I didn't really learn anything from her.
So your way of learning about it was through school?
Sex yeah, ed. Through school, friends, anything. TV, social network, you know. Tennis friends, like anyone.
Wow.
And my sister by that point, because my sister was younger than me for the first time. And and like after my dad died, we became closer, and especially with all my mom's crazy stuff. And then my sister, I started learning, my sister was doing all this stuff. I was like, what? My sister started telling me something. I was like, what? I was like, well, I'm behind here. Got to catch up.
I didn't have like an open relationship with my mom, so I never got a sex talk. And I didn't have, or had girlfriends at the time, but I don't remember having the conversation.
But they didn't talk to us about sex. I'm trying to think about how, only that nickel thing. They keep the nickel between your legs, and you won't.
So, like, where did you learn about the birds and the bees? Or who gave you that conversation?
I don't think, it definitely was not my parents.
Right. So was it a sister, a girlfriend?
Yeah, my sister's actually, like... Okay, so I got some of it in health class.
Right.
Yeah, because, you know, they start...
In high school.
They start doing sex ed, like, in fifth grade.
Oh.
Well, because they start telling you what the body parts are.
Oh, okay.
And they start telling you what the body parts are. And then I think I just knew what doing it was. I knew it was something. I didn't know what it, like, was, but I knew it was something you shouldn't be doing. Oh, and... They would always tell us, don't be fast. Like, but that's kind of like one of those half things. Like, don't be fast. Okay, right. But what does it mean to be fast? Like, because they never said being fast is doing it.
Right.
It was like, just don't be fast. So, okay, whatever that meant. Probably TV, probably like health class, a little from our friends. Then when I felt like I got to 8th grade, 9th grade. I don't know if I mean, I knew what sex was. I knew I wasn't having sex. Because I was just like, look, I'm not... I know you get pregnant doing this. Yeah. Like, because I knew people who were pregnant by then. And but I don't remember my mom having this conversation with me.
Wow.
No, okay. Not about... I don't remember having a sex talk with my mom. I think she was like, just don't do it. Or something.
Wow.
Sure, it was probably like, just don't do it. I don't even know. I don't even remember that.
Didn't have like really any communication with my mom about relationships. Like, it just was not, we did not have that type of relationship. Like, I would tell her if I had a boyfriend. So maybe like what was unsaid kind of showed up in all of my other relationships because I wasn't able to actually be vulnerable in any degree. And I think I only kind of figured that out in the past couple of years. I'm not even sure if I can think of like a friend telling me, Veronica, you have to be vulnerable. But I mean, all my dating advice came from my friends. I mean, I never went to my mom for any talk about dating or sex or... I think I called my mom once when I got a UTI and I was like, what the fuck?
Right. What is this?
I was like, what is this and how do I get rid of it?
Right.
But that was pretty... Oh, and then like, well, I remember when actually she did tell me, she's like, Veronica, you have to pee after sex. And I was like so mortified that she said that out loud to me.
But I never... I don't recall us having any... There was no conversation whatsoever. When she found that I was pregnant, and it was, she found out because I was not going to tell her. I was going to be like, and I was, I don't even know, maybe 5 months when she just asked me, are you pregnant? And I said, no. And she said, I remember it was July 31st of 1986. And she said, well, have you come on your period yet? And I said, not yet. And she said, not this month at all. And I said, no, not yet. She says, well, it's July 31st. At what point in the month are you going to come on your period? And I said, maybe I'm having a cycle change.
At what, 22?
Wow. That's what I said. Maybe I'm having a cycle change. I don't even know where I ever learned about that. But anyway, she I mean, she certainly scolded me. She called my aunt. My aunt came over, and what my aunt said was, well, the bottom line is, once you start, you're not going to stop. So if you don't want another one, you better get through this and get on some birth control. That was it. And my mother never said anything else.
What the bleep, people? These women were not only mortified, but it clearly shows there wasn't a solid relationship that existed with their mother, and their parents certainly didn't make them feel comfortable. I didn't get a chance to feel comfortable either, because I was shocked, speechless, confused. For me, my sex talk happened when I was at least 10 or 11, with my brother at my side. And we both had this generic sex talk at the same time. And frankly, I don't even remember even looking at him the whole time like siblings would normally do. So it was the infamous blue paperback book. This book I was hypnotized by to this day. As she was talking, I was just watching with this intent look without moving. And by the way, for nostalgic sake, I asked my mother for the book and she was like, what book? She doesn't know where it is or even remembers using it. I was like, oh, how sentimental is that? Okay, who else got the book? Well, I wasn't the only one. Listen to what these ladies had to say about their book experiences.
I was given a book on how sex works. I was probably like right before I got my period, I got it to like to 11 or 12. And it was just like, before sex ed started happening, so I learned everything in a book, and then sex ed started happening in school. But there was nothing of emotionally, it was just all functional. It was just, here's the book, and that's it. Like, we were a very passive-aggressive household, so, like, I didn't feel comfortable, like, asking questions. I just read the book, and that was it.
Yeah.
Tell me to check out a couple books from the library.
Now, I did, but that was even because friends were telling me, you gotta read this book.
So my mom did the whole point-and-click demo of her female anatomy, too, to call out what the main sexual organs are by their official name, but it was no deeper dive than that. Nothing beyond that. On second thought, maybe she knew she wasn't capable to deliver the full Monty, and that's why she made me and my brother watch Nova's The Miracle of Life documentary instead. I'm sure you've seen it. It's a great movie. But people, the only thing a 10 or an 11-year-old is going to comprehend is the whole sperm and egg fertilization journey. Case in point, me! Trust, all I was thinking about was, man, it's kind of cool that I was the sperm who beat millions of other sperm to the punch and fertilized my mom's egg first. Wow, I made it! So glad I made it. In fact, I probably have seen that Nova movie now, I would say at least 10 times. No lie. High schools, I don't know what happened, but they caught on, or eventually caught on, and started showing the movie zillions of times, which led me to be desensitized, right? I stopped paying attention even more, or because I saw it, I knew when to close my eyes during the movie in anticipation of what I didn't want to see. Something like, even watching the woman giving birth. I mean, I still actually remember it vividly. The starting point of the sex talk always begins after sex. Did you ever notice that? That it always starts when how a baby is formed or when the baby is in a mother's stomach and not before? When two people are getting their groove on, when does that talk start? As a 10-year-old, when I think about it, it didn't dawn on me in my parents' home to backtrack and ask about, well, where does the sperm come from and how does this all really happen? For the record, as close as I was to my father, I never had any sexual conversations. None. And I get it, it's a mom to daughter thing, it's a dad to son thing, but what if you don't have both parents in the home?
Like, I was so unsupervised. For a long time, I didn't take accountability for my own choices in ending up pregnant. I just could go where I want, when I want it, nobody knew, and this is how this happened. So for many years, it was everybody's fault but my own, and it was not gonna happen again. This girl is gonna know, and she's gonna be almost on a leash. Like, you know, my perspective has changed so much because I've learned that, okay, you made this choice. Nobody told you. You already knew right and wrong. So now I have anxiety about what to do, what to say, and when to say it when it comes to this you know, my
Is there really no right or wrong at 13 and 15? Right. I mean, you have an idea, but it's not.
Yeah, but you know, like at that age, I honestly thought kissing could lead to pregnancy. So why would I do more?
Right.
Okay. So in my mom's mind, the Nova movie allowed her to check another box. But in my adult mind, that didn't solve the problem. Especially when I got to college. I didn't have the internet growing up until later, maybe like halfway through college. And Google was certainly not around then to ask these questions. So let's look at the difference between sex ed then, when I was growing up, and now in 2016. So if you were an only child, you're kind of screwed, right? Because you don't really have anyone to go to. You have to seek the information on your own. And if you're the eldest sibling and there's no one else to ask these questions, you're stuck with finding the answer, making the mistake, and then you end up having to educate the younger ones.
This younger generation is more exploratory than I think any other generation previous to them. Or maybe our generation is just as much as exploring, but we just never verbalized as much. I don't know.
But that's the kind of thing that I wish someone had told me. Girlfriends, mama, somebody. Yeah, right. But nobody ever talked about that.
Now, I read a lot.
I read. I had to learn some of this because I'm the oldest child, so I didn't have an older sister to, you know, share some of that. So
well, I think one thing I like about this new generation, I mean, there's faults and there's not, that they're more open. Like, they don't mind talking about anything. Like, my mouth drops that when my little cousins talk to me. I'm like, do you know I'm older? I'm not your age. Can you, like, tone it down a little bit? But I really respect that they don't mind being that open, being around me, because I wish I had older cousins.
Yeah. So for me, sex ed class and PBS, they were all the theoretical, but not the physical or emotional check boxes, which really what was missing. Sex is exploratory, but it could be anything you want it to be, not just intercourse, okay? Let's be real, right? We're all adults here.
Can I get an amen on that?
I remember waiting in line with my mom in the bookstore over the holidays, and this book read 100 plus positions, which naturally piqued my curiosity. Not my sexual curiosity, because I wasn't even going there. When I opened it up to a random page of this thick hardcover book, it had these black and white illustrations of different sexual positions of couples. One guy on top, you know, different angles. Oh my God, I was so embarrassed. I slammed the book down in fear of people who had seen me open it up, close it, and out of embarrassment, my mom laughed. That was it. Nothing beyond that. In my mind, it was a missed teachable moment.
Nina's purpose is to empower women to celebrate women's embarrassing moments. If you're too shy, nervous, or embarrassed to ask about sensitive girly stuff, you're in the right place.
Ladies and gents, the benefit of learning about sex is bringing up the sex conversation before sex has a chance to begin. Starting with the basics, mothers, you need to desensitize yourself and children from any hangups. It's not limited to the sex talk, right? This conversation holds true in everyday relationships. Sex ed tip. The CDC study reveals teen girls who were sexually experienced, 83% told interviewers that they didn't get formal sex education until after they lost their virginity. So this is the approach that I would recommend, and one that I would have certainly preferred now that I'm older and I could look back. So at a young age, it should have been a Q&A session, right? Allowing me to get over the shock and the awe of the conversation, digest it, rid myself of the embarrassment, desensitize me from any hangups if I do have any, then allow the child to ask questions as things come up. In my house, it was always show and tell. It was one-way conversations, or it was show your attention to the television who has all the answers. Like others, I wasn't given a book to read, but when I was caught reading like a smut harlequin romance, I was shamed. I was shamed by my mother for reading it. But hey, it was my way of educating myself. Maybe not the right way, but I felt like that was what I had to do. There was no warning, no prep in advance to say, you know, Nina, this weekend we're going to sit down, we're going to talk about puberty, sex, the changes that you're going to undergo.
I never had time to be embarrassed because I always felt ambushed with no warning.
Certain information should be given at certain levels, and then as they age, you go in more in depth, you know.
Then after your period, the talk really should morph to like an emotional discussion around puberty changes that are taking place, in preparation to becoming a woman, what it means to become a woman, and just preventative maintenance in general. Beyond that, the parents should give a proactive conversation about relationships that are gender specific, right? What to expect from guys, the anatomy of a male and a female, how your body is going to react to affection and touch. And now we have social media, and just peer pressure in general are a few to consider. Listen to how these women recall their own personal womanhood conversations.
Oh, so when I got my period, my mother didn't explain to me that that's how you can get pregnant. I don't think she explained that to me. I mean, I think she said something like, oh, you know, she took me to a store and bought me pads and said something like, oh, she showed me how to mark it on the calendar. She said, mark it on the calendar every month and keep track of this. And she might have said, I don't remember my mom saying you can get pregnant. I don't remember her, but I vividly remember her showing me how to mark it on the calendar and telling me to keep track of it.
So she explained to you like how to change your pad and did you go on?
I don't think she did. I think she just said, okay, here's some pads.
And I figured it out.
Yeah, like, and I never, I don't remember, my mother had a hysterectomy when I was younger, so I never remember my mother having to buy pads or, and so when I started my period, I was the only person in the house buying pads. Okay, this is also what she told me, so maybe TMI. So you told me how to mark it on a calendar, and she also told me, make sure you always wrap it up. Like she said, be very clean about yourself. Don't leave stuff around, blah, blah. And it's interesting because my niece wasn't taught that lesson. And I had to get on her ass all the time about it. So it's amazing, like, what my mom was like, okay, mark it on the calendar, and this is how you...
Right.
But I don't remember her really giving me the information about, okay, your cycle's every 30 days, you can get pregnant when you're ovulating, and blah, blah, blah. I didn't get that till college.
Yeah.
No, I, like, called her, and I was like, Mom, I have... I don't think I realized that, you know, obviously, it's not the only way to get a UTI, but it's obviously a very common way, especially for younger women. And I don't think I knew that there was a connection between sex and UTIs. And so she knew I was visiting my boyfriend. He wasn't my boyfriend. He was just like this thing, and he was long distance and an issue-based relationship, you could call it.
Right.
And so I was visiting him, and I got a UTI, and so I called my mom, and she's like, well, Veronica, I have to ask you, did you have sex with him? And I was like, she's like, did you pee? And I'm like, can we stop this conversation?
Right.
But yeah, I know I called her just because, like, I didn't know what to do. I was in so much pain.
Instead, the sex talk consisted of scare tactics, negativity, wicked religious hymns, cultural reasons, I will kill you if you get pregnant, or if I will kill you if you get a girl pregnant drill. And then lastly, which I am certain most of us got this, just plain don't do it. Oh, this is another one. Have you ever noticed too that either the child or the parent reverse engineers the answer to the what do you know about sex question, where they opt themselves out? So the child will say, oh, Mom, Dad, I already know that. And then the parent just backs off and says, cool. And they're off the hook. And then you have the parent who backs out because the child interrupts them and says, oh, I already know the answer. Religion is often used as a scare tactic in most traditional conservative homes. Let's listen to how these mothers use religion to set the tone of the conversation. And you know what? Just end it with that, too.
You know, if you're doing something in secret, you know it's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Amen.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
That's true.
No faces. No faces. No faces.
Like, when you go to, like, Bible study or something, instead, like, the younger girls would go into a little group, and we would, like,
talk. They would teach you how to not have sex.
They would talk about your period. They would talk about sex. They would talk about school. They would talk about boys. They talk about friendships.
Yeah, they had that stuff in school, too.
Yeah, so I learned, my mom, her, she was famous, when you guys in a car, because we went to church in Upper Marlboro. No, we lived in Upper Marlboro, but our church was out here in Waldorf. Mm-hmm. Well, not here, but in Waldorf. So that 30-minute drive, she got in the car and closed, locked the doors. So I knew a lot of stuff by the time I got home. I knew about pads and my period coming and what cramps were.
That was awesome.
She told me, you keep your pants on. You're not putting your pants down for nobody. There was no, like, she just was, she made sure. And my mom got pregnant the first time she had sex. So maybe that's where it came from, because she wasn't young. She was like 17 or whatever, because I know kids 14, 15 had babies. So right, 17 too. Ain't necessarily young, for real. But she got pregnant the first time, and then he had two other girls pregnant at the same time. A couple months later, a couple of other girls pregnant. So I think that she was just like, no,
so
we're not doing
kids
it.
At like 17.
This is my brother's dad. He has at least like 9 brothers. Mm-hmm. They're all within 3 years of each other.
Wow.
She was very vocal, like, you're not taking them pants off. I remember when I was sneaking boys in the house, and it was like, oh no, we're not doing that. And she was very vocal. So, I mean, I didn't get all the details from her, but the no, you ain't doing it, like, I knew what a period meant, and I knew it meant I could get pregnant. No, she made sure you knew that.
Where I grew up in Trinidad, the nuns, we were in school with the nuns. So you weren't touching boys, you weren't talking about boys, you weren't kidding. So I was well prepared, I was good. I was not gonna get pregnant. I just knew we stayed far away from boys.
That worked.
I mean, was it functional? Was it appropriate?
That's why Kathy.
No,
that's what I they say about
exactly. Exactly. But
they're like, whoa.
Then you go
to
the opposite. Right. Yeah. But no, we didn't get a chance to do that. No, the nuns have been a lot. They take us on retreats. We would be with them on the weekends up at the beach, and they're just, you know, counseling us, that kind of thing. They just were not going to allow us to get pregnant, to be with boys, nothing like that. So.
Her, I explained to her that every time that she decides to have sex with somebody, that she's going to lose a little bit of herself with each person.
In what way?
I told her this is in a spiritual aspect. And a spiritual aspect leaves you a little empty, a bit void every time you give yourself to somebody. And the reason why I was telling her that is because I try to explain to her, you know, this is something very precious. This is something you don't want to just go share with any Tom, Dick, and Harry. This is something that you want to do when you are ready and when you are emotionally ready. Because a lot of kids, and I told her, I said, you're not emotionally ready for any intimacy like that. I said, heck, some of the adults I know can't even handle that emotional intimacy because it does take a toll on you. If you're, you know, giving yourself to this guy and boom, this guy got what he wanted and he moves on. You know what I mean? He leaves you hanging. So I was trying to explain these things to her, that it's not just something that you just share with everybody. And after that, after you give that away and after you kiss and after you make out, you're like a grown old woman. Mm-hmm. You've already done it all. You've already, you know, and there are certain things where you got to come back and find the small joys back in life again. And I'm not saying that that's a big major joy in your life, but what I was trying to explain to her was that she doesn't want to give of herself away every time to somebody else. You're giving a piece of yourself away to people. And again, you know, you're not going to find that in the Bible that it says that, oh, you're going to lose yourself or anything like that. It's not on the Bible, but the Bible does say that you become one with that person, spiritually speaking. Mm-hmm. So how many people are you willing to become one with?
You know what kills me is our parents act like it never happened. They have no memory of it. They just keep it moving. Or parents feel like they just gave you the all-you-can-eat Harvard Law School version of sex ed. You know, they just educated you with all you need to know. And you know what, girl? Now there's no excuses. Boom. They're off the hook. Or, like some people, you get the street cred Hard Knocks version.
My mother was like the square of the family. Like, my mother didn't play cards. She didn't really drink. She didn't smoke cigarettes. But my Aunt Joyce, she was the party girl. She was it. Like, everybody wanted to hang out at Joyce's house because you knew that it was going to be some funny smelling cigarettes. You know, it was going to be some drinking going on. That's where you play dominoes and you play cards, and this is where the fish fry happened. Like, my Aunt Joyce was that person. So as I got older, she was the person who, you know, I had those discussions about sex and relationships and boys. You know, we started that once I got older, but I was like maybe like 7th or 8th grade by then when those conversations really started.
My aunt shared with me, I didn't grow up with my mom, I got my cycle in Montreal, and she sat me down. She's a nurse, but really she just said, you know, at this time you have to be very careful, so, you know, you should stay away from boys, and that's it. Stay away from that as a nurse.
Right, she gave it to you from a professional perspective.
Now this is a tough one, the STD conversation. So my STD conversation was to use condoms. Know why, how, types of diseases, brand essentials. My mom did encourage me to buy them, use them, and have my own stash. She said, don't leave it up to the guy. School was a little more graphic, but you know, they skimmed over the whole condom drill, especially in Catholic school. My embarrassing story, ugh, goodness. I got chlamydia when I was in college, and I'll never forget it, because that day I was wearing these white elephant pants. Loved them to death. But I kept flowing, and I was like wet, and I was like, what is this? It's this yellow discharge flowing on my pants, and it wasn't just one day. It ended up being 2 days of nonstop. And I said, you know what? Let me just go to the doctor and get this checked out. So I went to this clinic near my house, and, you know, they were calling me nonstop, leaving messages every day. But, you know, I would either leave for class and come back so late that I never got a chance to call. And, you know, part of me was scared, too. So when I got there, they confirmed that I did have chlamydia. But the nurse yelled at me at this way that I'll never forget. She's like, you know, the longer you wait when you have chlamydia, it can make you infertile if it goes untreated. And then she's like, don't you want to have children someday? And I was like, wow, that was the tough love I needed to scare me straight. So here's how these two mothers from Girly Nation explain their sex talk strategy that works with breaking their cycles.
I saw my sister change, just completely change. And that broke my heart. And she's still not the same person.
Wow.
Since that time. And it was because, you know, your first love, and, you know, you think that they're your everything and everything like that. And she was intimate with him. He ended up, like, cheating on her. And my sister was so devastated. It's almost like I felt like she never recovered from that. And the sweet woman that she was, all of a sudden, or young lady, because she wasn't even a woman yet, she was a young lady, all of a sudden all these walls went up. And I saw this different person emerge that wasn't my sister. All these walls went up. This cynical person came up, and, you know, that innocence was just completely gone. And it was her first deception, her first time feeling betrayed, the first time she was ever devastated and experienced that betrayal. Because that's a huge, when we're young, that's why, emotionally speaking, we're not ready at that age for all that commitment. Heck, we're not even ready right now. You know, like, it's got to take the right person. And because some of these things, there's just such deep-rooted emotion in some of these things. And, you know, unfortunately, not all men are like us. You know, not all guys are interested in, you know, and I'm not picturing all guys to be like all these monsters or not. But unfortunately, you have your few that are. You know, they want to, like my one friend used to say, they want a warm spot to put it in.
Yeah, they just want sex.
That's all they want. She's like, girl, they want a warm spot to put it in. That's all they want. And I'm like, whoa, interesting, you know, but it's true. But yeah, so I saw my sister change, and I didn't want Ariana to be disillusioned by that. I didn't want her to go through those deep hurts where, you know, you just feel, I don't know, I can't explain it, but I just didn't want her going through that. So that's why I was very forward with her. And with my son, too, even though he was a guy, I told him, I said, you know, you can't be sleeping around, you know, you're going to leave a piece of you with every chick. And, you know, and I told him, I said, and, you know, there's STDs was one thing I constantly, like, just talked to them about constantly, very openly, and, you know, explain in detail what each disease and what each STD was and what it did and how what it looked
like. When she was in high school, I would give it to her, like, no holds barred. Like, let me tell you. To prepare her for college, and because she would have to be home alone sometimes. And don't think that you won't sneak boys up in here, because let me tell you what's going to happen. I would tell her. And I remember we first, we lived in Atlanta for a couple of years, and our employer had this thing from the Mayo Clinic where you could call and get advice or something. And they sent this book, and it was a book on like home remedies. And in it was a whole section on sexually transmitted disease. And what it looks like, on like vivid pictures on genitalia. So what a herpes lesion looks like on somebody's penis, and what is it gonna look like on your vagina? Like every, I broke it out. I was like, so let's sit down and talk about this. Yeah. I was like, she's gonna be so traumatized, but that's okay. I felt like I need to keep going.
Right.
So let's keep going. And so we talked about what is sex, what's gonna come from it, what is the purpose of it, what are these boys, is this boy gonna be here in 6 months? Do you really think so? Like all of that, because I felt like I didn't have it. I didn't get it. Now I have this 7 year old and I'm like, oh, I gotta do it again. I had so much anxiety about that. I didn't have it with Natasha.
So if you had a son or daughter, how would you break the cycle?
And as I think about the future and having kids, I'm just like blown away about like what, not that I want to stop them from consuming things, but just like, how can I just be so much more open to conversation? And really work through thoughts around everything. So it's not about sheltering people in the future, but just it's that conversation and having as many as possible. But it's allowing vulnerable conversations to happen and being vulnerable with children and girlfriends or whoever wants to have that conversation, but just like allowing that vulnerability to be there, ensuring that there's no shame associated with any of these conversations so that it allows for a continued dialogue so that children feel like they can come back after a conversation and ask more questions or discuss a situation that's confusing them. But I think it's being a vulnerable parent will be the only kind of guide I take with me.
So if you were that only child or eldest sibling I talked about earlier, chances are there is someone in your life that you refer to as your kindred sister that filled in all the blanks for you.
But then when I was about 15 and I started driving, then I started spending more time with my sisters because they lived in Atlanta and they were older. And then that's when I started getting a lot of the sex talk. And it wasn't like, Kim, this is what you do when you have sex. It was like, my sister was telling me about her relationships and having sex and, you know, don't let guys do this or don't let, they'll tell you this, you shouldn't be, you shouldn't be having sex, but I guess that was their way of teaching me about it, but they were actually telling me about, one of my sisters was more explicit than the other. The other one was like more motherly because she was like, could have been my mom. She was 20 years older than me. So it wasn't like, I'm not gonna share what I do, but she would always say, baby girl, this is what you have to look at. Boys want this, blah, blah, blah. You don't have to do this. You don't have to like everybody who likes you. That's probably the best piece of advice my sister ever gave me. You don't have to like everybody who likes you.
Right.
And my other sister just like,
she was more explicit with,
yeah, so she'd tell me like, this is this and you don't want to, you know. Yeah, she was very explicit, so got some of it from there. But I didn't lose my virginity till I was like 19, and by that time it was like, okay, so I got this. But it was still like a,
this is it.
Yeah, this is it. No, right. That's really what I was like.
Yeah,
that yeah,
was
this
my
is
experience.
It.
Yeah, this is, yeah, it.
Oh god. So my sister said this to me. She's like, she was like, be aware. She said, be aware of a man who always wants to do it from the back and in your butt because you just never know because he might be gay. Yeah, she told me that. She's like, be aware. If he always, if, oh. But yeah, she said, be, and she always told me, be aware of, this sounds really, really crazy. She said, be cautious when dating some men that are like cleanly shaven. She said it may, she's like, especially if they're not working in like corporate America, because it may mean they just got out of jail or they're gay.
Mm-hmm.
She says, so be aware of that. She said, you know, just
other than don't have sex. That was all the discussion, like, don't do it.
Right. So where did you learn? Was it through school only, or was there other ways you learned about sex?
It was through school, and I have an aunt. She's my favorite aunt, my Aunt Joyce. And as I got older, but this was just as I got older, she had those real heart-to-heart conversations with me about relationships and boys.
The last scenario is when parents hop on a moving train that are late to the station. You know, parents look for an out in this case. They ask a child if you know where babies come from. And if you say yes, perfect. Because they keep it moving like they're off the hook and no conversation ever happened. What the bleep, people? We can't go out like this, y'all. I have to end today's episode on a positive note, which is great because here not only did I find a mother who got the sex talk, but she's a mother who's doing the right thing. Amy is a 40-year-old woman who is a trainer who breaks the cycle. Listen as she tells her story about her relationship with her mother and her own two children.
In households, you know, where both parents are, if it happens earlier, I think it's at 5 or 6 that a child can make a distinction between the organs of a male and the organs of a female, you know, and that's a good discussion to explain it. They'll kind of remember it. But the key thing is different phases. And even after you've had the birds and the bees talk at 14 or 12 or 13, whatever age, it's not, that was the talk that's done. You know, you should leave the door open to say, you know, as you're going through this, I'm here to talk with you if you have any questions, because things will come up. You'll meet a guy who's going to say this. We can talk through that. Or you're going to feel this way. And I'm here, but it has to be where the parent is comfortable recognizing that the person is maturing and this is their one shot at helping them to get it right, as they mature. And rather than relying on their peers, we're still going to have those discussions, or relying on uninformed or inappropriate sources like porn or magazines and things like that.
My mom was an RN, so she was brought up in an era where they didn't talk much about anything. Sex was taboo. It wasn't anything that a mother enjoyed or even wanted to talk about, because it wasn't something that they did for enjoyment. It was something that they did for being able to have kids, right, for her mom. So my mom, being the RN that she was, had a ton of nursing books at home, and she was very straightforward with us about the sex talk. I mean, like, very straightforward. To the point where she shared those books with us. She was very forward with her views on sex and what happens, how you can get pregnant, and how it's something that you need to wait on. That's something that's reserved for marriage. And she was brutally honest with a lot of things, almost to the on the scientific side of it. And it's funny because, you know, in Puerto Rico, the way that some of the moms address it is like, oh, you spread your legs, you're gonna get pregnant, you know. And that's basically how some of them do the sex talk, but not my mom. My mom shared her books, showed us her books, talked about it, and was more concerned with making sure that we just weren't promiscuous. You know, she was talking about, you know, reputation in Puerto Rico at that time was a big thing, and having sex outside of marriage, how you'd be viewed, how you'd be talked about, it was a very big deal.
What age did your mom start with you guys?
I was like 9 years old, and my sister was 10, and yeah, so she was very open with us about that. And it's because I think I had asked questions, so.
Did you know to ask questions at that age, or was this like an ongoing thing throughout, like, your teens?
I think because of some of the things I had heard kids talking about, I don't know, I was just very curious. I just didn't buy some of the, you know, the stuff that my grandmother would say. Babies come out of your belly button, you know, like, she I was like, something don't sound right with that, you know?
Right.
So I just asked questions, and there were certain things, because my mom worked at the intensive care unit in a hospital in Puerto Rico, she saw some pretty violent crimes, sex crimes against women. So I think she also meant to also educate us on being careful, being watchful where we walk, you know, what routes we took home, and, you know, if encountered a certain situation, how we should address it, what we should do, you know, that kind of stuff.
Not all our mothers are registered nurses like Amy's, but I can say this. I would have rather have been traumatized like her and know the scientific facts versus being traumatized and sheltered with scare tactics and partial information.
My mom was a distracted mom. My mom was a mom that was trying to just put food on the table and put a roof over our heads. So things like having these talks, you know, like she did it, but on everything else, I don't feel like she was always present. She was more preoccupied with, I got to work, I got to pay the bills. So she didn't even get to enjoy us as children. And she'll say that to you today. If you talk to her, she'll tell you, you know, but next thing I knew, they were all grown up and gone and married and out of the house. she didn't treasure each moment. She wasn't like the motherly mom that, hey, let me do crafts with you. Let's go
to the park.
Go to the park. Yeah. Let's go to the museum. Hey, let's go. It was not like that. You entertained yourself. Yeah, and no, we processed a lot. And I sit back and think about it. And, you know, I raised my kids different. I let them be kids as long as possible. And I did that on purpose. I felt that I was protecting them. Mm-hmm. And I didn't want to shelter them, but at the same time, I was not going to have them be young little adults at 9 and 10. I didn't want them worried about finances, worried about how's mom going to pay the rent. Mom keeps saying she's tight, you know, and that's what we grew up with. My mom treated us like little adults, and I feel personally as I've grown up and look back at everything, I think that there are certain things we should have never been told. I mean, we were stressed out little girls, my sister and I. We were always worried about where we're going to live. Or is she going to be able to have money to pay for food? We were concerned with financial aspects that we should never been concerned with. I don't look back at that and go, oh, that was all bad. That was all negative. I mean, I will be honest. I wish that I would have been allowed to be a kid a little bit longer. But it's made me the woman that I am today. The wisdom that I have and the things that I know are through life experience. And I wouldn't have had any of that without going through what I had gone through. Yes, actually, I did not have that until I was 18. Yeah, and you know, and as soon as I did, I was very open and told my mom, hey, just want you to know, this is what happened. And her thing was like, well, you know, you need to get on birth control pill if that's what you're going to be doing, because you cannot be, you know. And I had already gone to Planned Parenthood without her knowledge. Okay. To start getting on some type of birth control. And I shared with her once I was sexually active, hey, you know, I'm already on birth control. My mom, she is 4'8", she used to be 5'2", teeny tiny, feisty. And she never knew how to beat around the bush. And to be honest with you, I'm the same way. I'm able to dress it up a little bit nicer than she does and present it a little bit better.
Yeah.
Without an accent.
Yeah.
And not so brutally violent, but I'm very forward as well. And I was like that with my kids as well.
So when you gave the sex talk to your kids, like, you didn't do it without any hesitation.
No, there was no hesitation. I think the first time that my daughter was in sixth grade, and this is kind of funny. She's like, Mom, what's a blow dryer job? I said, huh? I said, a what? She's like, a blow dryer job. And my son, who's 6 years older than her, he's like, you mean a blow job, Ariana? And she's like, yeah, that's it. I heard the guys at school talking about a blow job. And he looked at me and goes, Mom, would you like to explain that one to her? So that was one of the first conversations that I had with her. Now, I had a separate conversation with her, and then my ex-husband took my son basically on a retreat when he was in sixth grade, and it was actually recommended by Dr. James Dobson. He had a series of tapes that you played, and it kind of like went through the whole process, and they went to a hunting cabin, and that's when he decided to share with my son. And then I also, when they came back, you know, I also shared with my son as well. And then with my daughter, I was the one that did the sharing with her.
Amy describes how she had the talk and interacts with her own children from an early age to present.
When my daughter had her period, when she first started, she called me. She was a gymnastics. And when I'm telling you that we were very open, I mean, I was very open. But I addressed questions as they came. Okay. And at the different levels where she was age. So it wasn't like a one-time conversation. It was a continuance of the same conversation as things came up. And she, to this day, she still feels comfortable enough with me. And I'm going to be honest with you, she's 19 years old. And just the other day, her and her friend, you know, I was FaceTiming her, and I'm probably TMIing you right now. But she's like, Mom, what the heck is an orgasm?
Really?
What does an orgasm feel like? Yeah, she just asked me. She's like, what does an orgasm feel like? And I'm like, well, Ariana, you know, you will know. And I went on to explain, you know, the different stages, and I went on to explain the different, you know, like the muscular movement that goes on in your clitoris and the muscle and the contractions. And she's like, oh my gosh, you know, she's like, you know, I mean, we're talking about this. She's like, you know, I don't think I've had one. You know?
Yeah.
You probably haven't if you're asking me, I told her. But again, I have that relationship with both of my kids. I never wanted them to feel like they couldn't ask me or couldn't be open with me and asking me questions. I'm not their buddies. I'm not their best friend. I'm their mother. Oh, my mom did. My mom would tell me about, you know, you can't be doing anal sex because you get bacteria from the anus into the vagina. I'm telling you, everything was very scientific.
I wish I had that.
Girl, but I'm telling you, it just came out so forward that you were just, like, traumatized. Very, very forward. Like, you're like, oh, what the heck? You know, like, do people do that, you know?
Women, it's either... Some girls might discover it accidentally, maybe in their room, they're grinding the pillow accidentally and discovered, oh my God. Or maybe they're in the shower taking a bath, and or any of the accidental ways that they might discover it, but it's going to vary from person to person. Or someone might discover that they're aroused, and from touching themselves, they discover very quickly, oh, wait a minute, this feels good, and my body is actually feeling the effects of it. But they just don't, it doesn't occur naturally. And most parents never have those kinds of discussions with their daughters around, here are some alternatives in terms of how you might be able to deal with feeling aroused, especially in that adolescent period where your hormones are really running amok and you're feeling the need for affection and love and you're feeling horny and so forth.
They were both wondering. I was thinking, wow, I wonder what her friend thinks. My daughter just openly just grabbing the phone and calling me and just asking me that question. Mom, what is an orgasm? What does that feel like?
Yeah, well, that's probably why she probably said, well, let me call my mom because my mom will know the answer.
She does. And my son does the same thing. I'll call my mom. He was a not boot camp, but his first duty station that he was in. He's like, I'm going to call my mom and I'm going to ask her. So he calls me and he starts asking me these Bible questions on this different story about the different tribes and I go on to explain, and then I hear him say, and then I hear all the guys in the background, oh, and I'm like, what the heck, dude? He's like, oh, he's like, I told you my mom would know the answer.
Right.
So they were, like, doing, like, some type of debate about the Bible, and I used to teach Sunday school class in North Carolina, and my son was in my class. So I guess that's why he felt, oh, I'll call my mom. She'll probably know, you know,
the answer
to the story or whatever. They're funny.
Yeah.
But I always want to keep that line of communication open. Like, I want them to ask me anything, life.
Nocturnal emission for most males, boys between the ages of 12, maybe 14, is what we would call a wet dream. So you go to sleep. And in the middle of your dream, you might be dreaming about kissing Susie Lee. And before you know it, you're jumping up out of your sleep thinking that you're urinating on yourself only to discover that you just had an orgasm and there's this white creamy stuff that's here. And what in the world is this? And oh, by the way, it felt kind of good. I wonder if I can replicate that and get that feeling again.
You know, I didn't use a book. I just talked to them. With my son, I know my ex-husband went into that a lot with more detail. And I explained things to my son as well. And, you know, after explaining things to him, I'm like, you know, and the very first time that he had a wet dream, he was 12 years old, and he came in the room terrified. He didn't wake his dad up to tell him about it. He woke me up.
Huh.
He's like, Mom, I think I peed my underwear. And I told him, I said, no, I don't think so. Are you sure? He's like, yeah, I'm pretty sure. I think I did, you know. And I looked at his underwear and I said, honey, you didn't pee your underwear. This is your first, you know, like, I got to say, what dream? And I had to explain that to him. And I had to, you know what I mean? So that's why I'm saying, like, it happened and it wasn't all at once. It happened in different stages of their lives.
Yeah.
You know, like, as we encounter different things, I went on to explain different things. And if they had questions, I continue to answer them. And I gave as much detail as possible without trying to traumatize them.
On my show, we celebrate embarrassment, and it's called Keeping It 100. Girly Nation stepped up and shared their most vulnerable moments for the first time publicly. The end result is most of us either cringe remembering the sex talk or have no memory of it. Remember, according to Planned Parenthood, parents and children are now talking. But duh, they are not having a lot of the conversations, and it's not an ongoing thing. And that's what I'm preaching today. I'm preaching an ongoing thing, and I found the right women to tell their stories. In fact, Dr. Hilton is also on board with that approach. No matter how the sex talk was delivered or not, it represents an awkward, embarrassing,
empty, nervy moment for women. The shame or embarrassment never leaves, especially if we've tried to have it and it backfired in our faces. I was given the most extreme one-liners that a child really doesn't want to hear from a parent. As Amy pointed out, at first it's awkward, but then as we age, it becomes a fun conversation, or it can be. Daughters want to know more. Not having the talk leads down a path of uncertainty, bad choices, ugly outcomes, or not making informed decisions. Listen to me reading a few examples of what girls said, what their mother didn't tell them, but their girlfriends did when it came to the sex talk. Nope, I'm 28, and the most my mother and I have talked about sex is when she told me that asparagus tastes like sperm, and then told me not to ask how she knows. I was 14 and I recently got a boyfriend. She bought me a pack of condoms and told me she was too young to be a grandma. I knew most things about sex anyway, due to school and being a curious teenager with an internet connection, so it didn't need to be a long talk. My mom chucked a copy of some puberty 101 type book into my room and ran like it was a live grenade when I was 13 or 14. I already read a lot of her romance novels and had looked up a lot of words in the dictionary, though. And then there was this internet in the later half of high school. Nope, my older cousin talked to me about it. She explained lots of stuff, including slang, things guys will say to get you to have sex without a condom. She told me where to get free condoms and told me that I could always come to her if I had questions. She was pregnant at the time, so I definitely took what she had to say to heart. I ended up staying a virgin until I got married. Sex? I learned from school and friends. They were mostly boys and one girl best friend and the internet. Here's the real sad part. I didn't understand where boys put it until I was 16 and when I got my first period. I thought girls only had two holes. Don't ask the logic I had, it gets weirder. Now I have a great understanding because after I read almost every book in the library about sex, I even suggest things to friends who are now parents when they come to me for questions. But this lack of involvement from my mother is one of the many reasons why I don't have a child. I don't blame her, she was alone, but good thing I was a good kid who loved to read. I was also forced to watch my cousin's birth video. That was gross. Natural childbirth. Nope. No sex talk, no period talk. I often wonder if it was her that avoided it all or me. I pretty much kept everything to myself. Even when I started shaving my legs, I didn't let her know. I did have an older sister, so I just used everything she had. Razors, pads, tampons. If I have children, I hope I can be more open. Yeah, it might be an awkward moment, but if it means having an educated and informed child, bring on the awkward. No, my mom pretended sex didn't exist except to ask me if I was pregnant anytime I didn't feel well as soon as I turned 15. I got the talk from my older cousin, who was aware of my mother's approach. If they weren't around, I probably would have ended up pregnant before graduating from high school. My mother did her best to scare me into never having sex. A lot of emphasis on how much it hurts, how it's not enjoyable, but you have to do it if you're married. I learned from a medical book I found in the closet and a lot of TV documentaries. If you have kids, keep the dialogue open. I don't think it has to be too graphic or anything, but actually have a conversation and not take the easy road by giving them an activity book about anatomy. Kids don't know what's happening to their bodies. You know, women will feel terrified, especially if their mother seems to be closed off or embarrassed to talk about it. Sure, it's going to be an uncomfortable conversation, but it helps them out in the long run. Mothers, be straightforward with the talk. Women want your real-life examples to have the conversation and not shut it down with these off-the-wall comments or scare tactics, thinking that's how we learn as young adults. Smartphones and the internet, also known as Google University, is a sex ed class of its own. All the more reasons for parents to act as a filter, because you know what? Your daughters are going to find it out anyway.
Kids are going to do what they're going to do. You can educate them. You can tell them what you want. but also who they surround themselves by, who's talking to them besides you. We're not the only ones influencing them. They're constantly having people around them influencing them. So when they come back home, you always have to deprogram and reprogram and retrain and reteach and reteach, because if you're not influencing them, girl, by sure, somebody else will. I have learned to just step back and let them live and learn as well. I give you the information. I'm here for you. Ask me anything that you want. I'm not going to police you, and you still have to deal with your choices. And that's kind of how I've handled some of the situations. Now, I will say, though, I was strict when they were up until they were in high school. I was, you know, on their case. Oh, there's a party. Okay, give me their number. I'm calling the parents to make sure that they're chaperoning that party, you know, and I didn't like them just coming and going and whatever without any type of accountability. I wasn't having that. And my thought on that is, like, when you have a job and you start paying the bills here in the house and helping, then you can come and go as you please. But this isn't a hotel room. And these are the standards. Here's the expectations. And you know what I mean? And I didn't have that. My mom was so liberal that we came and went whenever we wanted to. So because of that, my sister and I, like, I remember establishing very strong boundaries. I was very, still to this day, because my mom wasn't setting those, so I had to set those for myself.
Girls want you to share what male interactions feel like. Sexual feelings mean, how not to confuse sex for love. They want to understand their anatomy and how they function. Also, it's useful to explain that sex should be consensual. What to expect before and after sex. The behavior of men. Why waiting makes sense, whether you decide to have sex or even wait until marriage. The point of it all is that it's totally normal and healthy. We all go through it. That's how it should be. But that's too much common sense. Common sense doesn't make the world go round. That's why I'm here, Girly Nation. And there you have it, Girly Nation. That wraps up another episode. Hope you enjoyed it. Please tweet you listened to this episode by tagging me on Twitter or Instagram at Nina Babel. Or you know what's even better? You could snap me on Snapchat. New episodes of the Keep It 100 Girls show drop every Tuesday on iTunes, SoundCloud, Google Play, Stitcher, and now TuneIn Radio. Don't forget to share this show with your girlies. Anybody that has a question or wants to tell their personal story, you can send your email to ask@ninababel. And I will feature it on an upcoming show. Give me some love, Girly Nation. Show me your girl hug by subscribing, rating, reviewing the podcast in iTunes, Google Play, or Stitcher. Girl, I'm still the new chick on the iTunes block. When you rate and review my podcast, you're helping me position in each iTunes category. You could also check out my videos on YouTube by typing in the search field, Nina Babel. Tune in to next week's episode where women will keep a 100 on their kissing styles. Learn more about their personalities when they reveal what kind of smitches they want to give or receive, and the difference between a good and a bad kisser. Any guys out there? Because you'll want to listen up. Thanks, girl! Smooches!